If you've ever wondered how to install baseboard where two different flooring thicknesses meet, then stick around and I'll show you a great baseboard step-down detail and how to make it. Hey guys, and welcome to another episode of DP Shop Talk. And today we're going to take a look at how to create a step-down detail for baseboard where two different flooring thicknesses meet. Now, what prompted me to make this episode was an Instagram post that I posted up a couple of months ago when I was working on site on a condo renovation. Now, I had posted a picture of the step-down detail that I created to deal with the two different existing flooring thicknesses that I had to work with. Now, the post exploded with likes and comments, and people were really interested in it, so I thought I'd make a how-to episode showing how to recreate that same detail. Now, if you don't already, make sure you follow me on Instagram at dpshoptalk to stay up to date with all the latest tips and techniques, tools, and projects. So before we get into actually making the detail, I'll give you a little bit of information about it. So it was 5.5 inch tall by 3/4 inch thick baseboard that I was using on site for that particular project. Now, where the transition happened between the laminate flooring and the vinyl flooring, it was very close to the corner of the wall, which made things trickier. Now, the actual height difference between the laminate and the vinyl was 0.5 inch. And you'll see how that measurement factors in to creating the step-down detail in just a few minutes. Now, I'm going to use the same setup that I used on site, which is my Bosch CM8S sliding compound miter saw and my Portamate saw station. I really like this setup for working on site since it's very lightweight and portable, and it's also very accurate and capable. Now, similar to what I did on my Bosch axial glide saw that I use in the shop, I made a custom dust boot that helps capture more dust. The dust collection was pretty good as is, like the stock setup on the saw, but that custom dust boot helped even more to get more of the dust, which makes a big difference when you're working on site in a finished space. Now, if you'd like more information on this setup that I'm using or any of the other tools that you see me use in this video, you can find more information as well as links down in the video description below. So a quick tip on finding the proper angle for a miter joint. I use the Sterrett angle finder for all of my trim work. You simply set it onto the corner that you're working with and it will tell you what the angle of the corner is, but more importantly, what angle to set your saw to for a perfect joint. So to avoid any confusion, I'll give each piece a letter designation, A through E, so that you know which piece I'm referring to as we go. You can also refer to the graphic in the lower left corner to see the piece that I'm currently working on, highlighted in orange. So I started with piece A, since it's just a normal piece with no special cuts. I tilted the saw to 45 degrees and cut one side of the miter joint that goes at the corner. Now obviously for a real situation this piece would be longer, but for the demonstration I'll just keep it shorter. So that completes piece A. Then I flip the piece end for end and cut the other side of the miter joint on piece B. Flipping the piece end for end creates the opposite 45 degree cut I need while keeping the saw in the same position. So now that the miter joint was done, it was time to start forming the step down. I tilted the saw back to 90 degrees and then swung it 15 degrees to the left. So the long point of the cut should be at the top of the baseboard. I aligned the blade so that the short point of the cut was about 1/16 of an inch to the right of the short point of the 45 degree miter cut. So that completes piece B. Then I swung the saw 15 degrees to the right and made a fresh cut to start forming piece C. So the long point of this cut should be at the top of the baseboard as well. So with that 15 degree cut made, I fitted piece B against it and applied a piece of masking tape to hold them together. Then I took my graduated square and placed the long leg of it against the bottom of piece B and slid it forward until the 1/2 inch graduation on the short leg intersected with the bottom edge of what will become piece C and made a mark. Then I removed the masking tape and made a cut at the same setting of 15 degrees to the right at the mark I just made. So this cut is parallel to the previous cut and completes piece C. Then I swung the saw 15 degrees to the left and made the angled cut to start forming piece D. So the short point of this cut goes at the top of the baseboard. With the saw back at 90, I cut piece D to final length, which is just an arbitrary length for this demonstration. I then took my offcut and marked half an inch back from the end. I cut at this mark to give me a half inch wide strip to start forming piece E. Then I swung the saw to 60 degrees to the right and made a cut on the end of that half inch strip. With pieces B and C fitted together, I again applied a piece of masking tape to hold them in place. I fitted in piece E with that 60 degree cut nested against the bottom of C and marked it for length. I swung the saw back to 90 and carefully cut at that mark to finish off piece E. So with all of the cuts made, it was time to assemble pieces B, C, and D. I applied a strip of masking tape to the back and then applied some glue to the joints and fitted and pressed them together, making sure that the faces were nice and flush. Then I used masking tape as clamps by sticking one end down, stretching it, and then sticking the opposite end. Then piece E got glued and taped in place. Now for gluing joints and trim work, I use a 10-minute wood glue. It dries quick, makes a strong bond, and it's more forgiving to work with than two-part instant glue. Once the glue was dry, I peeled off the masking tape. Now when I'm working on a trim job, I get into a rhythm where while one joint is drying, I'm working on cutting or assembling the next joint so that there's never any lost time waiting for glue to dry. Then I gave the joints a quick sand to make sure everything was flush and even, and then cleaned everything up with the vacuum. Next it was time to assemble the corner miter joint. So I applied some glue to piece A and fitted the joint together, wiggling it around a little bit to get a good glue bond. Then I used three Collins miter clamps to clamp the miter joint tight while the glue dried. I always make sure that the joint is properly aligned before I leave it to dry. Once the glue was dry, I removed the clamps and then reinforced the joint with a few 1¼" 18 gauge brad nails. Then I applied some fill to the nail and clamp holes, and once the fill was dry, I gave it a quick sand. I also gave the point of the miter a very light sanding to take the sharpness off. For the final step, I gave the whole thing a coat of paint to tie it all together and unify all the pieces. I always find that those finishing touches are the most satisfying part of any project. When all your hard work culminates into the finished product, and it's something you can be proud of. So that wraps up the baseboard step down detail. So with a coat of paint on it, everything is nice and seamless and all ties together and looks like one piece. Now, depending on the situation you have, you may not need to worry about a miter joint or the little filler block at the bottom there. Say your transition happens midway along a flat wall, then all you have to do is the step down. You don't have to worry about the miter. So this is sort of a worst case scenario almost when it happens right at the corner there and back a little bit from the corner as well. So it gives you a good idea of how to handle a trickier scenario. Now there's different options as far as dealing with two different flooring heights like this. You could rip down the baseboard on your thicker flooring or add a strip to the bottom at the thinner flooring. I prefer this method personally because then it keeps the vertical size of your baseboard consistent right around the room. You don't have two different sizes of baseboard running, but it's really a personal preference. So I hope you found this video helpful. If you have, don't forget to like, share, and hit that subscribe button. It's always very much appreciated when you do. As always, make sure you leave your ideas, thoughts, and questions down in the comments below. So thanks for watching, and until next time, let's talk shop.